Robbie, Grewal from me, Hrishi K, and everybody at Radio 1. Thank you for doing this interview and wonderful to talk to you.
Pleasure's all mine, Hrishi.
Robbie, when did you first get interested in the 71 war for Bangladesh? Was it during your school days, college days, or a little later as a filmmaker?
Hrishi, I'm actually come from a defense background. My father was in the forces. So by default, the world of, you know, espionage, army, defense, this is a part of my growing up years. And specifically to the 71 war and my film, about 6 or 7 years back, over a discussion with my father, you know, while having a drink, some facts came out. My father served in military intelligence as well. So I came to know a few things from his mouth about how the world operated back then, the world of intelligence and spying. And I was fascinated, especially coming from your own father. And I went back, I read a little about it, about 71, did a bit of research, and it just kept getting more and more fascinating. And over the next few weeks or something, I decided let's make a film on this, because nobody's really seen this world in the depth and reality of the world that there existed back in the day. And also, one very important point which came across in my research and my learning of that world was that we were the best in the world at that time. Our intelligence was probably, you know, number 2 or 3 in the world. We were on par with Mossad, KGB. And so that got me thinking, why were we so good? You know, one of the best in the world. It was because of a man called R.N. Kao, who's called the father of Indian intelligence, a fantastic, fascinating character who started RAW. So, yeah, so all these things kind of made me think of making a film on a story on of a spy who goes across, you know, with the world of espionage being the backdrop and the Indo-Pak war being the backdrop.
Robbie, I really enjoyed some of your film, and there's a question that a lot of people are going to ask you, saying, why did it take so long for you to do your next film after Samay? I understand that you've been very busy with ad films, but other than that, why the distance?
I mean, honestly, it's I, like you said, I'm an ad filmmaker, so that's my bread and butter. So you know, I only tell stories, or at least I feel like telling a story, when I have something very important to say. It comes from my heart. So I've been kind of struggling. I made a couple of films after Samay as well. Alu Chat was one of them. But I didn't have much to say for the last 10, 11, 12 years. You know, I was happy doing what I was doing. You know, my company is doing well. Everything was great. So there was no voice from my heart till I chanced upon the idea of 71, like I mentioned earlier. And once I chanced upon that, then I had nothing else to think of but that idea. And I've been, you know, working on that for like some 6 years, and breathing and living that story for 6 years. So nothing has mattered more to me than the story to be told. So that's why I'm here to tell the story.
Other than conversations with your dad, did you manage to speak to some intelligence officers? I mean, without taking any names, because it's very hard to pin them down.
Yeah, I mean, it took a lot of effort to reach a few people, honestly, through a lot of contacts, a few of my father's contacts. And again, off the record, they spoke to me. And, you know, the what you get from them is gold. What you get on the internet is really nothing. You get on typing on Google about spying, you get just the tip of the iceberg. And the kind of information I got from them, I know, was fascinating. Then I met some people from today's times, or a decade back. And I could see the difference in the world back then and, you know, 10 years or a decade back, and such a different world. The kind of, to give you an example of what I'm saying, I mean, the kind of, you know, there was no bureaucracy involved in back in the day. Like, the RAW chief could just call the prime minister and speak to him and have a meeting. Today, if you ask me honestly, if you want to have your stationery to be changed in that world, you would pass through 10 different files. So it's so much more bureaucratic. It's so much more bureaucratic today that the process has become a little cumbersome. It was straight up back in the day. Like, Mr. R.N. Kao was on one-to-one with the Prime Minister, and things could happen over a meeting. Today it takes a lot more. I guess that's where, you know, we are kind of not where we were, I feel, in terms of the world of espionage and, you know, the intelligence services that we have.
There are a couple of dialogues in the trailers and stuff that I picked up, saying that information is the most important weapon, you know, sabse bada hathiyar, as it were, in war. And in that aspect, we know that Pakistan has been trying to bleed us slowly and steadily, because they can't afford a full-blown war. And you're saying that the tools for accumulating information, we were one of the top three in the world. That's amazing. So why did it go downhill after that? Is it just because of too much political interference, or not having the right people in the RAW?
See, firstly, I think one should understand the meaning of the word intelligence, which is often spoken about, but what really means, what is intelligence all about? So wars are genuinely not won on the battlefield. they are converted into winning to a win in the battlefield. But the intelligence tells you where to attack, when to attack, when to defend. So intelligence is the backbone around which a war is won. So if your intelligence is not strong enough, you're somewhere it'll affect your performance on the battlefield. So why 71 war, if I could go back to it, 71 war was won principally on account of the intelligence of raw. You know, the kind of stuff they did back in the day is unbelievable. I'll give you an example of that. The use of media, the power of perception, which is a very off term used today. We were the first in the world, in the world of intelligence, to use media as a tool to put the story across for the world to know at the right time. True stories, correct stories, but at the right time. So Aryan Kaur was the first guy to do this. Later, Mossad followed suit on multiple levels with PLO, you know, Mr. Yasser Arafat and blah, blah, blah. But we were the first ones to begin this. We had a media cell back in 71 with RAW. So we are pioneers in that. So you can imagine being a pioneer. Today, it's a given word. Today, it's a norm, really. But back in the day, we were the pioneers of using this. So we were so good. This is one element I'm telling you about the world of spying, espionage back in the day. And why we are... It's very simple, honestly. You got to spend, you know, there's a certain allocation of money, budget given to the services. And I don't think we are spending enough money on it. Anything in the world, you got to spend money, put your time and effort into it. And I guess that somewhere we're lacking in that. I think it's very important for the government or whichever government is in power, is that the importance of intelligence should be kind of coming out better. You know, whether there's a budgetary allocation on it or whatever else that goes along with it. So that's where something I feel you're not spending enough money on it or spending enough time on it.
Jagu Dada seems to be very fond of you, Jackie Shroff. Yeah. And I was talking to him and he said, you know, I love the way that he's underplayed Mr. Kao. And he said, you know, that has nothing to do with me. You know, it's all Robbie. And he was in Samay. Yeah. So have you been in touch with him throughout the odd message here there? Or did you meet him or how?
See, Jagu Dada is one of my most favorite people. I'm saying it not because he's saying nice things about me. He's genuinely, we all know what a fantastic guy he is. And one of the larger heart, you know, with a large heart and a beautiful man. So it's been I've been in touch with him off and on, but not consistently enough. And honestly, I've been itching to work with him. For one, he's a fantastic actor with a great presence, and two, he's a fantastical human being. So both these points are really the reason why I've been dying to work with him, and I'm so happy that he's done this film with me. And like he said, it's a beautifully understated role. It's something where, you know, you reach the emotive content of the high of the film through understated way of putting it across. You don't have to, you know, beat your chest to create a certain emotion. You can do it in a very different way, yet come to the same emotion, because at the end of the day, the emotion is what makes or breaks a film. So Raw is a very emotional film, but told in a manner which is not, you know, beating your chest or in a jingoistic manner. And he's played a very important part in telling that story.
And we're all very fond of John, so I'm really happy that you know, he is the principal hero in this particular film of yours. And really, I think it's come at the right time in his career. I don't know if 10 years ago, he would have been up for the challenge, because everybody talked to him as an action star. Then, of course, Madras Cafe came, changed that. And in between, he showed us wonderful glimpses of his acting. Were you always convinced that John was RomeoAkbarWalter?
Honestly, I'll tell you, when John was discussed with my producers, I was a little skeptical, because again, I had the perception of him being an action star and somebody who's done big, huge action movies. So I was not very sure whether he would react to it in a positive manner. Again, purely based on perception. I didn't know him from before. But to my surprise, when I met him, I found him to be one of the most intelligent men I've interacted with. The grasp of story, the understanding of a character, the nuances of a character, he just got it immediately. You know, what I would take, let's say, about 10 meetings with an actor for him to understand the mental conditioning of the part he's playing, he got that in 2 meetings. So he is, I'm just so happy with the way, 5th April, we'll know how the people feel. But I'm very, very hopeful, having worked on the film with him and, you know, he's performed in the film. He's done exactly what I wanted and a lot more than that. So, again, back to the point of timing, I'm not sure the timing, whether 10 years back you've done the part or not done the part. Everything comes together at the right time, and this is the right time for him, for me to come together, and I'm really, really happy to have him in the film.
I understand that you can't say too much about Moni's part, because it'll be giving too much of the story away. But the fact is, you know, that with Gold and this one coming back to back, both have a kind of a retro feel to it. Is it because she looks like the quintessential, you know, classic heroine or a very retro feel, like let's say Sharmila Tagore had at one point of time, since you know Gold is again dated, this one is again a 70s film. Is that the reason you picked her, or is there some other reason?
No, she does have that old world charm, which is one of the reasons which worked for her for this part. Also, having met her and you know interacted with her before I started filming her, I found her again to be somebody who understands the part well. My fear with her, I'll tell you honestly, was her TV background, because what happens with TV background is lots of times actors become very rehearsed because they do so much of work and they have a regimented performance situation where they have to just do a certain amount of work in a certain amount of time, so they lose the spontaneity. And with her, what I realized, what really worked for me for her doing the part, was very simple. She was very spontaneous. She was not rehearsed, which is a bit of a dichotomy, because like I said, TV actors usually become very rehearsed over a period of time, and she's done a fair bit of TV, but her strength lies in exactly the opposite point. So yeah, old world charm, spontaneity, and you know, like I said, I can't talk about the character too much, but the kind of character she plays, she just felt the part.
And if you have Raghuveer Yadav as part of your ensemble cast, you know that you can actually place a lot of responsibility on him, and he can hit it out of the park. So are you in a position to tell us what Raghuveer plays?
See, Raghubai plays a Pakistani in the film. I can say that much to you. He plays obviously a very important part in the film. Beyond that, I don't know how much I can say. But yeah, what I can say is, when Raghubai is in your team, you know, it just motivates everybody to do a better job. As a director, I am, like, he's so good that, you know what I mean, there's a certain responsibility to give him a part which does justice to his talent. So you work harder on the part by default, and people around him also by default. You know, it's a classic, it's a cliche again, but a good actor breeds a good performance from the other actor, and Raghubai is exactly that. When you put him across any actor, by default the other guy will perform better. So actually it's a vested interest for me to make everybody look better and perform better, and when you have a guy like Raghuveer Yadav in your film, so yeah, I mean, it helps on multiple counts having him on board.
And it's these are wonderful times for Sikandar Kher, because he had one release last week, which is Million Talkies, and here he is back again in your film. So did he just get lucky? Did he have to keep coming and meeting you, keep auditioning for the part? I believe he plays Khuda Bakhsh, who's again a Pakistani general. Yeah.
So Sikku, I didn't know from before. Again, Sikku is a friend of mine now. He's a fantastic guy. I mean, I love hanging with him, talking to him. Really funny guy. I'm sure you've interacted with him. So Sikku met me one day. He just came to my office. Honestly, I didn't have him in my radar for the part he's playing, and he came to office and just, he walked in and he just felt the part for me. Casting is very, very instinctive. You just feel that guy is good for the part. It's a feeling. It's not really a studied or a methodical approach to casting. It's just feels correct, and he felt correct. I had not seen too much of his work, honestly, but I'm telling you honestly, after working with him, he's one of the most talented actors we have around. I mean, he's, and the kind of effort he puts in the part, and he's just so naturally gifted. I would want to have him in every film I do. He's so good. Yeah. Besides being a friend, now the sheer talent he has is, he surprised me, I'll tell you honestly. Because the way he performed, the way he worked hard on the part, once he's the film, hopefully everybody will feel the same way. But he's fantastic.
Now, couldn't you just call it Raw, or are there any copyright issues calling it after a government body, or you know, did you have to come up with Romeo Akbar Walter as far as the titling of the film is concerned, Robbie?
Honestly, Romeo Akbar Walter is the title of the film, because it's what the story is about. These three names are integral to the plot of the film, and they really are the reason why the story is called Romeo Akbar Walter. So Raw is the abbreviation, honestly. So it was never meant to be Raw, because Raw is the external security agency we have, and it's not just about that. It is about Romeo, Akbar and Walter. So it's always meant to be Romeo, Akbar and Walter, and Raw just is an abbreviation which works. You know, it also some way talks, says Raw, and Raw is the agency which is there in the film, so it works on that level as well. But it was never meant to be called Raw. It was always Romeo, Akbar and Walter.
As a services boy, you know, with your dad being in the forge, you must really be feeling wonderful that there are these back-to-back films on the forge. For example, Meghna's Razi, which we all enjoyed, which was, you know, just straight to the point, talking about espionage. Then there was Uri, where there was a slight bit of jingoism, but then I guess you needed that chest humping. And here comes your film. So it's wonderful that we're making more films on the services. But, it's a question you must have got asked before. but how different is Raw in terms of all these other films?
See, the first point about the Fauji kid, I'm genuinely very happy that the Fauji, the army, the services is portrayed in a realistic manner today. Back in the day, it was just a little caricature-ish in terms of depiction of the services, but today it's getting real. So, which is great because stories of valor are coming out and you really are getting the point of what services mean to the country, and that too in a realistic manner, not in a jingoistic manner. So, it's fantastic. I'm really happy with that situation. What are the other questions? Sorry.
Yeah, so what can we expect from Raw in terms of feel?
See, Raw is a very emotional film. It's a spy drama, but it's, you know, the moot point of Raw, the main emotion of Raw when you finish the film, you come out of the theaters, what I want from the audience is to feel pride in the guy that John is portraying and consequently feel proud of yourself being an Indian. So it's the Indianness which I'm trying to take out in the most honest emotional form by the end of the film. So it's about pride. It's about pride of being an Indian. It's about pride of a story of a man who goes across and what he does in the film. It's sheer pride to see on screen what he does, and I want to evoke the Indianness in you.
Did you write the dialogues and the screenplay yourself, Robbie, or did you have somebody doing the dialogues and the screenplay for you?
No, I mean, a story and screenplay essentially is done completely by me. There's a few partners who joined me. There's a guy called Rahul Sen Gupta who's done an additional screenplay with me, who works, and we work together in the agency world. Then some dialogues are written by some Urdu, is helped by a guy called Ishraq, who helped me with the Urdu dialogues. There's a guy called Shreyans Pandey, a young kid who's worked with me on dialogues some time back. So yeah, so a few people have joined in to, you know, help the narrative, make the narrative better.
And you know, with espionage thrillers, you need, your cinematographer is pretty much like your arms and legs. So who shot the film for you?
So the DOP is a man called Tapan Tushar Basu, ad DOP, advertising DOP. Again, we worked a lot in the past in commercials. It's actually more than arm and leg, honestly, in a spy film, because spy film, what happens is the mood is the backbone to a film, because the mood defines the story. You know, nothing against a love story where also DOP is important, but the mood and the texture you create in a spy film is the basis to telling a story. So if you don't get the texture right, however good actors might perform, you won't feel that spy espionage, that world, that the tension in the air, the reflections, the mood. You know, that is imperative to tell a good story. So DOP becomes so important, and also the background score, if I may say so. Hanif Sheikh is the man who's done the background score. So the DOP, the background score, you know, they are the mood, the pivots around which the story is told, especially in a spy film. So I've been very lucky to work with fantastically talented people who have given me a lot more than what I asked for in terms of the mood and texture and the detailing. So I feel good with what we have done with the film, with the right people who have worked with me in the film.
And some nostalgia came in because I was YouTubing the film and Rabbi Shergill is back. I haven't heard him since Bulla Ki Jana Main Kaun.
So Rabbi Shergill, I mean, I'm a huge fan. I'm a Panju from Delhi, Sardar boy from Delhi, so I'm a big fan of his. I love his music. I love the voice he has in his songs, and his you know, the poetry he has in his songs. So yeah, it's just a pure nostalgia for me. I loved him as a singer, as a voice, and I wanted to work with him and got him on board for the song in the film. So yeah.
And I'm so glad that you've actually got him there performing, you know, so it's not just a playback thing. And so there's also a Vande Mataram by Sonu Nigam. So will that come in seamlessly in the background? Does it move the story forward? Are you going to break for a song like Bullia?
It's a spy film, so songs by default are not that important. It's not a love story. But one has tried to do in the narrative of the film is keep the songs a part of, like, keep the dialogues with the song. So what one is doing is, in a song is playing, there's certain dialogue scenes happening along with it. So it doesn't feel like a song. And they're not placeholders. They're actually, about a minute or two in the film, which play out. And also there are multiple songs in the film where we have scenes happening along with the songs. So there's a qawwali. The qawwali is being played and the two principal characters are talking along with the qawwali. It pauses. It's in the background. They have a discussion over a point in the film narrative. We come back to the qawwali. So it becomes a narrative tool versus let's pause the film, let's put the song, let's start the film. So that's the attempt in the narrative of the film using.
Who really surprised you in your cast, Robbie? I mean, or were they all just predictably good? You expected them to be that way. You know, sometimes a director comes away and says, wow, I didn't expect her or him to do this, but they really stunned me. Maybe in a scene, or even if you don't need to tell me about the scene, but I'm just saying, an actor who really surprised you.
See, again, it might sound a little cliche, but actors surprised me, honestly, not just an actor. I'm to begin with John, honestly. John was somebody I knew he'll do the part really well, because I saw when I gave a narration to him, I saw the way he reacted to the film. He was excited like how. So I knew, and he's talented, you know. He's a very, very intelligent actor, very perceptive, very intuitive. So I knew he'll do a good job, but when I said the film today, at the sake of sounding a little immodest, he's done a fantastic job. He's taken it to a point beyond what I thought he would. Also coming from the action lineage and, you know, the perception, because when I signed him, Parmanu had not released, so he was still a Madras Cafe had done well as an actor, but he was still in that action big film kind of a zone. Then, I mean, Siku, like I said, Sikandar, I mean, fantastic. I mean, he got some nuances in the narrative, in the character, which I didn't really think of. So what happens for a director is that a director can think holistically about all the characters on a certain level. But when an actor comes in for the part, he brings something to the table which you don't think of. So that's where the real deal is. That's why, you know, a real good actor really makes a difference. He doesn't just take your vision. He takes your vision to the next level with his nuances. So Siku, for example, has done that. Jaguda. I mean, he's, you know, the thing about Jaguda, I'll tell you honestly, he's one of the most good-looking men. And, you know, so I've attempted to take him back to the days where Jaguda was, you know, like fantastically good-looking, a man with presence. So I've got that old world thing about him in the film. So besides being a fantastic performer in the film, he's got that old world charm which I've not seen in him playing a part in the recent past, honestly. So I'm very happy that he's got all of that back, and he just feels like a Jaguda of the old, you know, the one when I grew up watching a hero, or you know what I mean, when you were kids, and like, what a fantastically good looking man, what presence. So yeah, I've subconsciously tried to get that back in the film, and he's you know, delivered for me fantastically well.
Robbie, as a director, is there a film that you go back to and say, wow, what a film? I mean, so many learnings from it. I wish I could make this. Could be a Hollywood or an Indian film.
Sure. So, you know, growing up, I'll tell you, in college in Delhi, so one had no idea about filmmaking, or one had no idea about one will make films in his life later or whatever. Just a regular college kid in Delhi. So one or two films which stuck, they happened during my college days. So one for me was Satya. I'll tell you why, because Still Satya happened when somebody was shot, there was a background score with it. There's a song playing, or drama. Satya was the first film I saw as a kid, as a 19-year-old, and somebody shot and you didn't know he shot. Boom, he's gone. And the scene moves on. So you're so shocked by the killing. You know what I mean? It's a cinematic tool which I never knew existed before I saw Satya. So Satya for me was a wow moment in my, you know, watching films life as an audience, where it just turned the point of a narrative structure can be done differently. And subconsciously, it played a part in my, you know, wanting to do cinema, very subconsciously, honestly. But just looking back, like you said, in nostalgia, another film which really, really was fantastic for me again in college times was Sixth Sense. I mean, you saw the film, you came out of the theater, you were like zonked, you were like, what happened here? Like, you went back home, it's like, oh my God, this is how it happened. So it made you think. You could not get out of the film till probably a day or so. So yeah, these are the films which come to my head immediately as an audience, which was so, so fantastic.
Lovely. Okay, last few questions. It'll be just lifestyle questions before we wrap. Is there a travel destination you went to recently or in the past and you said, wow, you know, this is it?
I travel a fair bit. My wife is we have a pact. Every year we take a month off. So because of her, I have seen a lot of the world, you know, Argentina, Japan, Brazil, Amazon, pretty much a lot of Europe. So I've seen really, really fantastic places thanks to her. And I'm not a travel junkie. By default, I've become a travel junkie. And the cliche that as it sounds, what it does, it just, you know, it subconsciously changes your perception of things. You know, it's not knowingly. It's not like you go abroad and you go to a fantastic place and you learn something and you learn. It's just back of your head. Your mind opens up, you know, just seeing places, seeing people, meeting people, and you kind of become a better person in some way without you knowing it. That's the beauty of it. You never really know it. You know, your mind is opening up, horizons are getting wider, but you never see it like that. So just looking back over the years, traveling a fair bit, like I didn't even know where things kind of got into my head of things opening up. You know, your mindset changing, your just perception, perspectives of things were changing. And that's what traveling does. Without you knowing it, that's the best part. You never think of when you go to a place. It's later when you come back. And like today, actually, I'm just thinking aloud. You know, it just changes so much for you.
Yeah, people say that nothing prepares you for South America, for Argentina, Brazil. It's crazy. Nothing like anywhere in the world.
Yeah, it's crazy. I mean, the Amazon is, it's an experience one should, if you can travel, it's a place you should go to. It's so beautiful. It's so beautiful. I mean, I had the rare chance of spotting anaconda. They say that my guide said he's seen it about 7 times in his life. You never spot them. Because they're in the water. So we saw a baby anaconda. One memory I have. But overall, I mean, it's just not. I won't say it's about the Amazon or it's about A place or B place. Just the difference in kind of the kind of people which all over the world are. The difference in the world they live in, the kind of people they are. It's so different. So it's just like Japan, for example. I was there for a month. And the people are so beautiful there. I mean, like, I'll give you an example. Like, there was Ashra on the bus stand his job was to make people stand in line. It sounds like the most boring, ridiculous job. You know what I mean? It's like, what can you, 10 people, you make them stand in line. But his dedication to his job was so beautiful. He would do it so diligently. When your feet goes there, say, sir, could you please come and stand in line? So just the element of loving your job, however small it might seem to A or B, but just the passion in Ashra's job to make people stand in line in queue of a bus stop. I mean, where do you see that? And he was so happy doing it. He was so passionate. So that's a learning. You know, no job is small or big. If you're passionate about a job, it's so beautiful.
Have you ever done any adventure sports on any of these trips? Some bungee jumping?
Yeah, we love, I don't know, adventure or not, but we love skiing, me and my wife. So we've skied in Niseko, in Japan, in Argentina, in the US. So now we have a kid, so skiing takes a backseat for the last 2 years. But earlier, all our travel destinations were centered around skiing. So we find a ski spot and then work around the destination that we are in, around the skiing. I've done the, skydiving. I'll repeat that. So yeah, I've done the skydiving, bungee jumping, the regular tropes. One is on that.
What can we do at an individual level? What do you do, or what does the family do to save the planet? Like, for example, in our place, you know, we make sure plastic doesn't come in. You know, somebody would say we don't litter. So what is it that you do at a personal level?
You know, on a personal level, I keep getting my wife back into the interview, but she is the, organic, real nature freak. So by default, I've become a bit like her since, you know, after whatever years of marriage. So yeah, one doesn't use plastic, one shouldn't leave the tap on. Sound a very menial small little thing. When you wash your hands, pull it off, wipe your hands 20 seconds, then put it on back, because water is precious, like we all know. Keeping things clean, I mean, garbage disposal sounds very trivial, but has to be done correctly. Wastage of food, when you go to a 5-star hotel, I'll tell you honestly, you go to a buffet, we have this very, very bad habit as Indians, piling up our plates with food. Because it's a buffet, you will leave half the plate back and go home. Terrible. I mean, it's a buffet, you can keep going back and feeding yourself as much as you want, but why pile that one plate with a mountain of food, eat half of it, not even half, and leave it behind and go back? Terrible. It's sheer wastage of food. Yeah. So some habits we should change a bit. Like I mentioned, these are the few things which come to my head.
We're also doing a campaign called Run with Radio 1. So we're finding out if people do running as cardio. Are you a cardio person at all? Do you run on the treadmill or do you run on the outdoors?
I was a big cardio person. I used to run, not on treadmill, outside. And I was prepping for a marathon about 5 years back. I had a terrible back injury, so I've been off cardio for 4 years now, but I'm itching to get back to it soon.
My last question is, who's your BFF? Who's your best friend forever? Could be from the industry or outside.
Honestly, I don't have a BFF. I have my school friends in Delhi who are my, close friends. But again, it's not like a BFF, but they are a clique of friends who have been with me and who are friends of mine, like from school, which have stuck and been there and now will always be there. So yeah, so the BFF concept has not really not worked for me in the literal sense of the word. So yeah, so no BFF as such.
Robbie, I can't wait to see Raw. All the best, and thank you very much for this interview.
Thank you, Rishi. Cheers. Thanks so much.